So now we will be directly going to discuss wind tunnel procedure, because the equivalent static wind analysis procedure is already discussed in the conventional session. So now I'll be focusing directly on this wind tunnel procedure. So I'll start with what this procedure is, and then how we can use its results to analyze our building in any program like ETABS. So I'll be using actually the lecture slides prepared by Mr. Kani, and I am thankful for his permission to use these for educational purpose. And I'm also thankful to AIT Solutions, because these slides contain several of the images and projects which are done by AIT Solutions actually. So I'm just using them for educational purpose here. So with this acknowledgement, actually, let me start with the basic introduction of what wind tunnel test is. Actually, the complete test procedure is comprised of three parts. The first part is the simulation of natural wind in a tunnel. So we actually recreate that boundary layer or simulate that natural wind which our structure will be subjected to. The second part is the scaled model which we construct of our building, and it includes of not the model of our own building but the buildings which are surrounding that building. So all of these, for example, white or gray color models, they are the surrounding buildings, and this is our building which we want to test. And then third part is the measurement of force, pressure and wind speed. We can determine the force which is experienced by our scale model due to the application of that wind simulation. And then we can also measure pressure, and we can also measure wind speed. So this is the third part. So the complete setup actually is composed of these three components. This is the wind tunnel which is situated in Thammasat University. It is the combined wind tunnel facility developed by Thammasat University and AIT. It is the atmospheric boundary layer wind tunnel. It can reproduce or simulate the atmospheric boundary layer, which means that it is the lowest layer of troposphere that is directly influenced by the presence of Earth's surface. So actually, you recreate the surface roughness or the type of exposure which your building is going to have, and then the boundary layer is reproduced or simulated in this kind of a tunnel. So you can see that it has a cross section which is 2.5 meter by 2.5 meter and a length of 22 meter, and then it is equipped by a very strong electric motor which is capable of producing a wind speed of around 25 meter per second. So you can reproduce the atmospheric boundary layer, simulate that actually atmospheric boundary layer in this wind tunnel, and then we can place our model on a table here, and that table can be rotated, which means that we can change the angle of attack of our wind, and then we can test our building in any direction. So the very first step in starting the procedure is wind climate analysis, and you actually have to derive the wind climate model from the analysis of all the meteorological data, historical data, and then that climatical environment have to be mapped to the wind tunnel test data actually, so that the responses and wind loads can be predicted. So in order to obtain reliable and accurate wind characteristic at a specific site, the wind model is combined with the terrain analysis, and this can be the target wind properties of the wind tunnel test. So we have to get all those climatic data. Sometimes the wind speeds at a particular site, they are described by this kind of a rows, which is sometimes called as the wind rows actually. And let me show you a clear picture of a typical wind rows. It shows the wind speeds actually in different directions, and it shows actually the frequency of all the wind speeds recorded at a particular site. So it's a graphical tool which is used mostly by meteorologists to give a clear view of how wind speed and directions are typically distributed at a particular site. So the frequency of actual wind speed in different directions is plotted on this kind of a rows or this kind of a graphical tool. So it uses polar coordinates. So you have this coordinate system, and the frequency of winds over a time period is plotted by wind direction. The color band is actually denoting the wind speed here. These bands actually they are denoting the wind direction, and the direction of the longest spoke shows the wind direction with the greatest frequency. So you have these frequency on these radial lines. So the longest spoke actually has the highest frequency. So all of that data, the wind speed data at your particular site, helps us in actually getting a clear picture of what wind speed should be used for this wind tunnel test actually. Then wind simulation in wind tunnel, we use spires and roughness elements actually. You can see here, these are roughness elements spires to generate both mean wind velocity and wind turbulence profile. We know that the wind speed, it increases as the height increases actually. It is modified at the surface or close to the surface. And similarly, the turbulence is maximum at the near the surface, and it reduces as we go up. So both of these properties, the velocity profile and turbulence profile, we have to simulate in wind tunnel. And for that purpose, we have to use these roughness elements actually to simulate that wind profile actually. The wind characteristic in wind tunnel test will be adjusted to represent the prototypical natural wind, and there should be a number of trial tests which you have to done, which you have to do actually to obtain wind profile. When it is stabilized, then it is ready for the test model to be tested. So here you can see as an example, obviously it is taken from AIT Solutions, one of their projects, that all the dots here are shown the normalized wind speeds at different heights. So you have height on y-axis, normalized wind speed on x-axis. So the dots are the actual wind tunnel test values, and this profile is the profile corresponding to the urban exposure. So now you can see that it is matching well. Similarly here, you can see that the dots here are showing the wind tunnel values, and it is the longitudinal turbulence intensity. And you can see here that it is matching with actually the urban exposure longitudinal turbulence intensity. Similarly, this is another example from one of the AIT Solutions project, where you have different mean wind speed profiles for different exposure. For example, open terrain, this one, then suburban, and then you have the urban. And the dots here are actually the wind tunnel values. So you can see here, the dots are the actual wind tunnel values, and then they are matching well here, you can see. So you have to actually make sure before the actual test that the wind simulation in wind tunnel is actually representing the real scenario or the real wind profile which your structure is subjected to. Then the overall wind tunnel testing can be used for three purposes. Actually, all of these three kind of studies are the services provided by IT Solutions. So the overall structural wind load study is the first study which is mostly used. The wind tunnel testing is mostly used for this purpose actually. And you actually calculate or measure the fluctuating wind loads by either of the two techniques. One is called the high frequency force balance, HFFB, and other is called the high frequency pressure integration, HFPI. And I'll explain both of these techniques in next slide. So if you want to have an overall structural wind load study, you may use any of these two approaches in wind tunnel testing to determine the wind loading for the application on your computer model. The second is the cladding pressure study. The local wind induced pressures, which can be directly measured from the test, wind tunnel test, and it can be represented in the form of pressure contour to assist the facade engineer in design. So the outer cladding of building can be designed on these pressures, which are determined in this wind tunnel testing. And the third type of study is the environmental wind study. It is the study of outdoor, you can say, wind environment, whether it is comfortable for pedestrians, for example, at different key areas, such as walking, entrance areas, outdoor seating, recreational areas, and all of those, you can say, for example, studies which assess the human comfort level for any intended use of a particular facility, this kind of study is involved. So overall, wind tunnel testing can be used for these three common purposes. One is to determine structural load. This is the very first purpose. And you can also determine the cladding pressure to design cladding or facade. And then third is the environmental wind study to determine the human comfort level or any wind related issue associated with open door areas or recreational areas and, for example, entrances. So this is an overall summary of what a wind tunnel test can be used for. The first type is the structural wind load study. Then the second is cladding pressure study, and third is the environmental wind study. The key results which we can obtain from structural wind load study is the floor by floor wind loads, which can be applied to a computer model to analyze your building for wind analysis. Then motion sickness assessment, for example, the building acceleration against wind loading. If it is more than a particular level, then you can have motion sickness. The occupants can have motion sickness. So this kind of a study can be used to actually assess whether you will have motion sickness or this kind of a hazard or not. And then obviously this kind of first study is benefit for structural engineers to design the structure and main wind force resisting systems. And this motion sickness is something related to serviceability. The cladding pressure study, the key results which you obtain is the local wind pressure. So you will have all the pressure contour on outer surface of the building as a result of this study. And the facade engineers in cladding design can use it for the optimization of cladding design, and the cost can also be optimized based on the results from this study. Then finally, you will have environmental wind study. Wind speeds at pedestrian height, for example, is one of the output which you can obtain from this study. Pedestrian comfort and safety assessment, this also is part of this specific study. So all outdoor activities, all outdoor facilities, any wind issue associated with those facilities will be handled in this environmental wind study. So actually this can be used for architects in planning outdoor areas and whether those facilities are safe or they will remain functional against a particular wind hazard or not. So I'll be directly discussing the first type, which is the overall structural wind study, which is directly related to structural engineers. So you will have actually two types. You can actually perform this test in these two manners. First type is called the high frequency force balance. In this approach, we will be calculating actually the fluctuating wind loads using force balance in terms of base shear, base forces only here at the base of the building. So our model will be actually subjected to natural simulation of a natural wind, and then the fluctuating base reactions are calculated as a result of that application. So the time history of base shears and base moments are recorded, and then those time histories are distributed along the height of the building to determine the story level forces which should be applied to the computer model for the design of that building against wind loading. So high frequency force balance records the time history of forces at the base of our model only. On the other hand, we have the high frequency pressure integration, in which rather than measuring the wind load at the base of the model, we measure it at all surface of that model by using several sensors. So all of those pressures at the surface, for example, if this is the model, you will have many sensors on its surface, and all those sensors, actually those sensors will be integrated there. The pressure at each of the part of that outer facade or outer surface will be calculated, and then you will integrate all those pressure to determine the actual loading on the building which should be applied to design that building. So the distribution of wind load can be directly obtained from the measurement. You already know the distribution of loading on the surface along the height also. So unlike the force balance method, where you record at the base only and then distribute it along the height, here in the high frequency pressure integration, you directly record on the surface. So the distribution is directly available. So you can see here in this particular model, there are several points on the surface, which are actually the pneumatic tubes, and they are connected to the pressure sensors. So those pressure sensors provide us finally the pressure values at each point on the surface. So both of these techniques can be usefully used to obtain the wind loads for the finite element analysis model. And then once we obtain those loads, we apply to our computer model to actually design or analyze our building against wind. There is a third approach also called aeroelastic approach. But mostly in buildings, we use these two approaches. In that aeroelastic approach, we actually focus more on the aerodynamic damping, the positive aerodynamic damping, and that is a special case when the cross wind response is significant. We may go for that third option, but mostly we are focusing on, in buildings, we are focusing either on high frequency force balance or high frequency pressure integration. The reason we call this as high frequency, both of these methods, is that our reduced scale physical model, this model, have a significantly higher frequency compared to the actual reduced scale model of the real building. So it is you can say a very stiff model, so that the recording of wind forces at the base or at the surface, it is not modified by the actual dynamics of the building itself. So therefore, they have to be very high frequency models. So you can differentiate between these two techniques by having a different, you can say, scheme of actually recording the responses, actually not responses, actually the wind forces. So conventionally, we know that the equivalent static wind force provide us the floor by floor equivalent static wind forces, and we apply those to the finite element analysis model. But we know now that with all of these latest technological advancements available to us, now we can have time history analysis also, the rigorous dynamic analysis also against wind. So the time history wind load measured from the high frequency pressure integration test can be applied directly to the finite element analysis model. So whatever result, whatever pressure values you obtain from this second approach, this one, at each point you directly get the pressure value. So you convert that to force value and then you can directly apply it in your computer model. So we can now have the rigorous dynamic analysis also for wind case. So we can use either of the modal superposition method, which is the modal response history analysis, modal RHA for dynamic analysis, or we can also go for the direct integration scheme. Both of these are available, for example, in commercial programs like ETABS, and also your computer model can be both linear and non-linear. So now with this computational power available and all those advances, it is possible for us to have detailed non-linear time history analysis also against wind. So this is again a summary of the first approach, high frequency force balance. As I have explained, that we construct a reduced scale physical model and then we have the force balance at the base of this model, which is capable of recording the base reactions, the shear forces and three moments, moment about x, y and z axis at the base of that model. So we simulate the natural wind in wind tunnel and we record the time histories of these reactions. And then we combine those time histories with the dynamic properties of the building to obtain the forces and responses. On the other hand, the high frequency pressure integration method or approach, in this approach, instead of recording the time histories of forces at the base, we record at all surface. So we have pneumatic tubes here spread along the surface of the building, which are connected to pressure sensors, and finally we get the detailed pressure contour on the surface of the building as a result of this wind tunnel test. So it is possible for us to measure the pressure on each surface and then we convert that to force, and then force can be applied directly to the finite element model. So similar to the high frequency force balance technique, here the integrated wind loads, the pressure can be converted into wind loads, and then those loads are combined with the structural properties, dynamic properties, to determine any forces and any demands or any responses. So the second step after the decision of what approach will be used, in fact third step actually, because the very first step would be the simulation of natural wind, the simulation of the boundary layer, that is the first step. Then second step is the decision of which approach should be used for wind tunnel test, either force balance approach or pressure integration approach. The third step is actually the construction of physical reduced scale model, and in that obviously it depends on what kind of study you are performing. If you are using the force balance approach, you know already that the time history of the reactions will be recorded only at the base, so you don't need to have all those sensors on the surface. If you are going for pressure integration, just like this, you have to have pneumatic tubes at each surface, all the surface, which should be connected to pressure sensors, which are mostly inside the model. So there the pneumatic tubes are located on the surface, which actually are exposed to wind, and they are connected to pressure sensors, which directly record in real time all the pressure values. So if you are going for a force balance model, you are going for this kind of a model. And then if you are going for pressure integration, then this model. Sometimes these models are also constructed using 3D printers, and then some are also constructed using CNC machines. So for force balance model, the model is required to be very lightweight and stiff. It should be a very high frequency model, as the name indicates for this approach also. So this model have to be very stiff to achieve natural high frequency, and typically external surface will be lightweight material combined with high modulus string at the central core. So at the core of that model you may have a very high modulus, maybe metallic core. The pressure integration model is also sometimes used for cladding study. In this model is built by using state of the art rapid prototype technique in order to meet high degree of accuracy. Also complexities of the building shape are incorporated in this. The model is then instrumented. All the pneumatic tubes are installed in all those areas where you want to measure the pressure, and they are connected to the pressure sensors at the other end. And then you should also have the surrounding model, all the proximity buildings or wind blocks or all those the components or you can say infrastructure which can modify the wind which is applied to your building. All those should also be reproduced. All those built facilities which have the capability to modify the boundary layer, they should be part of that wind tunnel test. So you can have several models, for example, one force balance model for your own building and then several of the surrounding models, or one model for your pressure integration study and then several surrounding models. So this is few examples of few projects, and they are obviously taken from, these slides are taken from AIT Solutions. So you can see here that here the white color models are all surrounding models, and this is the building which is being tested. At the back you can see here that this is all the roughness and spires. They are actually constructed here to simulate the natural wind or the exposure which is available for your building. All these models are installed on a rotating table. You can rotate that table or platform with different degrees to change the angle of attack. Here you can see a pressure model, and it is developed using rapid prototype technique. So all the complex outer geometry and shape that is captured, and all those white models are the surrounding buildings which can modify or influence the wind profile or wind characteristic which your structure is subjected to. So some more figures here, you can see this is the building which is being tested, and all the others, they are the surrounding buildings. You can see the roughness elements here, and you can see the table which can be rotated at different degrees so that the angle of attack can be modified. This is the inner view of one pressure integration model. You can see the pneumatic tubes inside the model which are connected to pressure sensors. So one output of this kind of structural wind load study is the assessment of whether the occupants will have motion sickness or not. So if the wind induced acceleration is more than a certain threshold level, the occupants will experience the motion sickness in the building. So here you can see an example that for different return periods, for example 1 year and 10 year, there are two comparisons shown here. For 1 year you can see that the green dot is representing the actual level of wind induced acceleration, it is 5 mg, and the threshold value according to some standard is this one. So in this case you can see that the wind induced acceleration is lower than the threshold value. Here also you can see for 10 year return period wind, the recorded wind induced acceleration is less than the threshold value. So in both of these cases the occupants may not experience motion sickness. But this kind of a study can be performed using wind tunnel test. Apart from the structural wind loads, you can also obtain these kind of results from a wind tunnel. We know that one specific issue, or you can say effect, associated with wind loading is vortex shedding, and it is a very common issue. And the issue is that because of the wind load in one direction, the structure oscillates in the perpendicular direction, and when the frequency of wind matches with the natural frequency of the structure, the building may resonate, and then it can be a very serious issue for several shapes and types of buildings. So the aerodynamic modification or change in the shape of outer surface of the building is sometimes carried out, and different tests can be performed on different shapes in wind tunnel to finally avoid these undesired you can say undesired phenomena or some special issues or dynamic effects associated with wind loading. So different kinds of shapes, different cross sectional or outer shapes or facade, or you can say the cladding directions and orientations are tried in wind tunnel sometimes to come up with the most optimum you can say combination of economy as well as the structural response. So once you perform the wind tunnel test, you finally obtain the wind loading in the form of either point loads, which are dynamic load, point load applied at each story, or they can be area pressure loads. If you integrate those area pressure loads, you can convert them into point loads also, or those point loads also can be obtained by transferring, or you can say distributing, the base reactions along the height of the building. So finally you will get this kind of a detailed results. For example, here in this graph, the force in x direction is being shown at different levels. So you have for example this level, this force fx, and the history is shown here for 1 hour span. So you have the complete history for all the duration of the test. Similarly, for this level you have another value of force, for this level, for this level. Finally, actually you will be getting the dynamic forces for each level and for whole duration of the test. Now you can use those dynamic forces, apply them to your finite element model for detailed wind analysis. So here one example, this is the pressure integration model for one dome, which is this one. This is a project by AIT Solutions. You can see here that all these red dots on its surface are actually pneumatic tubes which are connected to pressure sensors. And at the end of the analysis, once you apply wind loading to that, you can see that the pressure contours can be plotted in this manner. So you can see all the colors here are showing the pressure coefficients, red being the highest in one side and blue means the highest on the other side. So you can plot these kind of pressure contours if you can go for the pressure integration scheme. One result from the wind tunnel test can be the equivalent static forces also. You can obtain these for x direction, for y direction, and for the moment about z axis, the vertical axis. So actually these are the, you can say, torsional moment for building. So these three equivalent static forces can be calculated also, or can be obtained also as a result of the wind tunnel test. Then you can apply that to your numerical model and then analyze your building. Also sometimes these are compared with the code values also. Code also provide us the equivalent static forces. These are first compared with the code values, and then a decision is made based on that comparison. The second kind of study which you can perform using wind tunnel testing is the cladding pressure study. So as the name indicates, you might have guessed already that you have all the pressure sensors spread along the outer surface. So finally you can get the pressure contours on the surface. So here you can see an example building. This is the actual reduced scale physical model, and it is surrounded by the proximity buildings, and it is on the rotating table. After the wind tunnel study, you can plot this kind of a cladding pressure contour actually. So you can see here that the red color is highest and blue color is lowest. So you can identify the areas where the pressure is reducing or it is increasing. So at each point you have a specific value of pressure at each point of the sensor. So this is the same building, positive pressure, which means the wind is applied from outside, and then the negative pressure means the suction pressure, which means from inner side, inside of the building. So you can see that these kind of contours can be plotted as a result of this wind tunnel testing. This is a comparison between the wind loading calculated from the building code, one building code of Thailand, and the wind tunnel test results. So you can see that the building code prescribes the constant wind loading along the along certain height levels or ranges. So therefore the external pressure, cladding pressure, is constant for this part and then changed for this, then remain constant again for this range. But the actual distribution of wind pressure or cladding pressure obtained from the wind tunnel test is this one. So you can see here that for example this red color or orange color is very high pressure. It is here in the as prescribed in the building code, but actual study showed that you may not have that high pressure towards the top of the building. So if you go for that wind tunnel testing, you may save you may achieve a lot of economy here, a lot of cost can be saved if you go for this more accurate option of wind tunnel testing. Moreover, you can also identify several areas where the pressure is actually higher than what is prescribed in building code. So for example, here you can see that it is blue color, but here it is yellow color. So there are several dynamic effects like downwashing or some other effects related to the outer shape of the building, which are captured in the wind tunnel test, but they may not be captured in the typical code approach. As I have said in the start, that the code approach is actually mostly applicable to typical regular buildings, and it is applicable mostly to low rise buildings. And finally, the third study can be the environmental wind study, where you can see that the passageways, for example, the outdoor areas, for example, outdoor restaurants or rooftop restaurants, or all those open facilities, the wind comfort level at those facilities is assessed, evaluated in this study, and finally you can use that space better, or you can design or arrange different facilities in that space in a better way. There are some special effects which are considered in this study. For example, one is called downwashing. When the winds are obstructed by the building at certain heights, the wind can flow downwards also, which is sometimes called downwashing flow. This can be mitigated by having these kind of canopies, for example, in buildings. There is also an effect called channeling effect when the buildings are located in close proximities, and then you can have several channels of wind which is flowing between two certain buildings. This is called channeling effect. All of those things are accounted in the wind environmental studies. So here you can see a model which is used for this purpose, that there are a lot of outdoor you can say outdoor or proximity models which are surrounding your actual model which is being tested, and on top on rooftop you have pressure sensors installed or wind sensors installed which actually give you the wind velocities and wind forces at that particular outdoor location. So these kind of studies also can be performed in wind tunnel test. If we go for chapter 31 in ASC 7-16, which is focusing on the wind tunnel procedure, it is actually first setting the scope that there are certain conditions. If your building is meeting those conditions, you should always go for wind tunnel procedure, right? And then there are certain test conditions. Actually, ASC 7-16 refer mainly to ASC 49 to have all those to prescribe all those test conditions. Similarly, for other test issues, test related issues and all those related details, ASC 7 refers to ASC 49. So I'll directly show you ASC 49 first. This is ASC 49 document, which explicitly talks about wind tunnel testing for buildings and other structures. And you can see its contents, that it first talks about the simulation of boundary layer, and then the local and area averaged wind loads, overall wind loads, and then the extreme wind climate towards the end. These are those conditions for both directional procedure, and on the right hand side you have for envelope procedure. If your building satisfies these conditions, you should go for wind tunnel testing. So a building that has designed wind loads determined in accordance with this chapter, which means the directional procedure, shall comply with all of the following conditions. The building should be regular shaped, and that is defined here, and the building does not have response characteristic that make it subject to across wind loading, vortex shedding, or instability caused by galloping or flutter. So if any of these special dynamic effects are there, and if your building is not regular, if any of these two conditions is satisfied, you go for wind tunnel test. Similarly, in envelope procedure also, these are the conditions, same conditions are prescribed. So you are referred to chapter 31 if these conditions are not fulfilled. If your building is not regular, or if your building have some special dynamic effect associated only with dynamic wind loading, for example, the vortex shedding or instability induced by galloping or flutter. Then some other details which I'll be skipping here in the chapter 31 about how we will be characterizing the load effects in the wind tunnel test. There is another important report related to this. CTBUH have a working group, and the output of that working group is this wind tunnel testing of high-rise buildings. It is highly recommended report, and it talks about some of the important issues related to wind tunnel testing of high-rise buildings.